The hour of convening having arrived, all members of the House will please report to the floor and take their seats. All members of this House will report to the floor. We're going to have the morning roll call shortly. Clerk will ring the bell. All members will please take their seats. We're going to have the call of the roll. All members present will please vote green to signify their presence in the chamber, and the clerk will unlock the machines. Have all members voted? Have all members voted? Have all members now voted? If so, the clerk will lock the machines. Doorkeepers will please close the doors and keep them closed. Chair apologizes that we're a few minutes behind the announced time to begin, but I've realized that Rules Committee was meeting, and not only were the members of that committee out of the chamber, but members that had an interest in being there, and so we just had a busy morning so far. But good morning, it's Friday. Hope you don't have dinner plans back home. Just a little pleasant thought to get the day started there. We will begin our day with scripture reading and prayer by the chaplain, after which we will pledge allegiance to the flag of our country. Our chaplain this morning will be introduced by the lady from the 56th House District, Representative Abel Mabel Thomas. Representative Thomas.
Let the church say amen. Amen. All right, thank you very much, Mr. Speaker and members of this distinguished body. It is my pleasure to present to you the chaplain of the day. Pastor Carol E. Dixon got her start in ministry as a local Bible teacher in 1977, then became a missionary in her local church in 1980. Pastor Dixon started her career as a television producer and daily TV talk show host in 1981. She accepted the call into ministry in 1984 with a daily noonday prayer time, and everyone began to call her throughout Pastor Carol. Dr. Carol E. Dixon, senior pastor, life coach, author, motivational speaker, with earned degrees from Wayne State University. She is so thankful for the opportunity to share the greatest message of all. She is committed to helping people from all walks of life experience the unconditional love and unending hope found only in a personal relationship with God. By 1993, Dr. Dixon's ministry had grown by leaps and bounds with churches and satellite offices, teaching citywide, statewide, and countrywide, even stepping into worldwide ministry by taking tours to Israel, Rome, Greece, Jordan, Egypt, Russia, China through Carol Dixon Ministries. Dr. Dixon is a leading Bible teacher and speaker. She is the founder of Carol Dixon Ministries Worldwide. In her sermons, empowerment conferences, and books, Carol Dixon's message is rich with revelation, yet easy to understand and put into practice. She has authored several books, including Unchain Your Mind, Liquid Prayer, Back to Basic, New Breed, and a handful of Christian articles. Her latest book, 60 Seconds, is available on Amazon.com. Today, Carol Dixon is a widow with three grown children, two are university graduates, and the youngest is in his third year of college. All three of Dr. Dixon's children are involved in some faction of Christian ministry. She is yet speaking and traveling to teach, train, educate, and equip. She can be heard daily through morning inspiration because truly she is a woman of vision and voice. Thank you so much. I would like to present to you my pastor, my leader, Pastor Carol E. Dixon. Thank you.
Good morning. I know that we all know the story of the creation of the Bible and the part where God made man. That's very interesting because many times we read that, and the part that so intrigued me is in Genesis 3, around the sixth verse, when God asked Adam, "Where are you?" Here is an omniscient, omnipotent, omnipresent God asking a question of man. But it's more behind it than that. What he was saying is, what are you thinking? Where's your mind? What caused you to lose your moral compass? What happened in life that made you forget about the instruction that I had given? Where are you? Where are you mentally? And then I read a story in John, the fifth chapter, about a man who had sat at the pool of Bethesda for over 38 years. The verse that intrigued me so much was when here was Jesus and he asked him a question. Do you really want to be whole? Omnipresent, omnipotent, omniscient. Asking, do you want to be whole? What was he really saying? He was really saying, where's your mind? What's going on? You've been here 38 years, and legend had it that every year an angel came and stirred the water, and whoever got into the water first got healed. You've had 38 opportunities for change, but there were always excuses. What are you thinking? What's going on? Do you really want to be whole? Adam's choice and your choices bring change for life. That was his option. And then not only his life, but generations to follow. Thank God that we've been given an opportunity through Jesus. As the man at the pool of Bethesda, to feed, to free, to focus our mind upon what he says. And in so doing, the verse that follows says, immediately, the lame man got up and walked. Immediately, he was made whole. I also was intrigued by the fact that he didn't pick up his bed and walk immediately. It says, immediately the man was made whole. What brought the difference? Well, the whole story says that he had been in that environment. Five porches was filled with lame, impotent, diseased people all around him. He had to first feed upon the instruction and really listen. I've been sitting here. I've allowed my condition to consume me, and I've done nothing. And everybody else move, and all I have is excuses. So, first of all, he had to feed upon what Jesus was saying. When you think about yourself, am I complacent where I am? Do I really want change? Do I want to make change? I can't deal with all of this around me. I've got to begin to look within myself. Feeding up on the Word of God is the best instruction you could ever have. It'll begin to change your mind without you doing anything but reading it. And then from that, it freed him. And he was able to take that, that had been a security place for him, a place where he'd gotten comfortable and complacent, and he changed things and picked it up and walked. Today, I submit to you this morning that God is more interested in changing your mind than changing your circumstances. And if he can get you to change your mind according to truth and don't believe a lie, then it'll change generations to follow. That's the opportunity that's presented. Let us pray. Father, we give thanks for the United States and its government. We hold up in prayer before you these men and women who are in positions of opportunity in this great state of Georgia. We pray and intercede for the state of Georgia House of Representatives and all those who are in authority over us in any way. We pray that the Spirit of God rest upon them. We pray that skillful and godly wisdom has entered into the heart of these great members of the Georgia State House of Representatives, and knowledge is pleasant to all of them, to every county, in every direction. We pray that discretion watches over you, and understanding keeps and delivers each one of you from the way of evil, and that you be true to the responsibility entrusted unto you. Therefore, I speak that your abilities measure up to issues before you, that you be thorough in your investigations and factual in your presentations. Therefore, I speak that your insight be without oversight, discernment without distortion, fairness without favoritism, prescience without prejudice, and a clear conscience without compromise. Therefore, I speak strength to stand tall, even if alone, for it is better to cease in something right than to win in something wrong. So be it resolved that we give thanks for the land of Georgia and the leaders which have been given to us through you. Lord, the great House of Representatives of the state of Georgia, guide us this day in this meeting, and God, remind us that all we do here will be reviewed in the council halls of the last day. In God's name we pray. Amen. Let us pledge allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and unto the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Doorkeepers will unlock the doors. Chair recognizes Chairman Chokas, the chair of the Committee on Information and Audits.
Good morning. Good morning, Mr. Speaker. Your Committee on Information and Audits has read the journals of the previous legislative day and have found them to be correct.
Chairman Chokas, the chair of the Committee on Information and Audits, reports that the journal of the previous legislative day has been read and found to be correct. Is there any objection to the confirmation of the journal? Chair hears none and the journal is confirmed. The clerk will read the resolution establishing the order of business for the day.
Mr. Burns, the 159th moves the filing be established as the order of business during the first part of the period, unanimous consents. Introduction of bills and resolutions. First reading of reference of House bills and resolutions. Second reading of bills and resolutions. Reports of standing committees. Third reading and passage of uncontested local bills and resolutions. First reading and reference of Senate bills and resolutions. Morning orders.
Is there any objection to the adoption of the resolution establishing the order of business for the day? Chair hears none and the resolution is adopted. First reading of bills and resolutions. The clerk will read.
House Bill 1097 by Representative Gates, the 73rd, floor of the 64th, Mabor of the 63rd, Ramsey the 72nd. A bill being entitled an act to amend the act providing for compensation expenses of the chairs and members of the Board of Education of Fayette County.
Intergovernmental coordination.
House Resolution 1526 by Representative Spencer, the 180th Corbett of the 176th. A resolution honoring the life of Mr. Colquitt George C. G.
Transportation.
Russell. House Resolution 1527 by Representative Parsons, the 44th. A resolution encouraging the enactment of a religious freedom amendment.
Energy, utilities, and telecommunications.
House Resolution 1528 by Representative McCall of the 33rd. A resolution honoring the life of Mr. Jesse Rouse.
Transportation.
Senate Bill 258 by Representative Miller of the 40th and Albers of the 56th. Bill being titled an act to amend code section 48-5-311 of the official code of Georgia annotated relating the creation of county boards of equal
ways and means.
Senate Bill 302 by Representative Martin of the 9th, Burke of the 11th, Underman of the 45th, Watson of the 1st, Perrin of the 42nd. Bill being titled an act to amend title 33 of the official code of Georgia annotated relating to insurance.
Insurance.
Senate Bill 331 by Senators Thompson, the 14th, Hill of the 32nd, Cowles of the 46th, McCoon of the 29th, Ligon of the 3rd, and others. Bill being entitled an act to amend code section 15-11-2, entitled 19 of the official code of Georgia annotated relating to definitions for the juvenile code.
Judiciary.
Senate Bill 365 by Senator Schaefer, the 48th, Couser of the 46th, Miller of the 40th, Wilkinson of the 50th, Harper of the 7th, and others. Bill being titled an act to amend code section 40-2-86, the official code of Georgia annotated relating to special license plates.
State Planning and Community Affairs.
Senate Bill 367 by Senator Kennedy, the 18th, Miller of the 49th, Dugan of the 30th, Jones of the 25th, Kirk of the 13th, and others. Bill being titled an act to amend to provide for comprehensive reform for offenders entering and proceeding through and leaving the criminal justice system.
Judiciary non-civil.
Senate Bill 388 by Senator Lucas, the 26th. The bill being entitled an act to amend Article 3 of Chapter 27, Title 50 of the Fish Code of Georgia annotated, relating to bona fide cone operation amusement machines.
Regulated industries.
Senate Bill 419 by Senator Williams, the 19th. A bill being entitled an act to amend an act establishing a state court of Wayne County.
Intergovernmental coordination.
That completes first readers.
Second reading of bills and resolutions. The clerk will read.
House Bill 1093 by Representative Hightower of the 68th, the bill to amend an act providing that the tax commissioner of Carroll County shall retain 1% of educational funds collected by said officer and remit the same to the governing authority of Carroll County to reimburse the county for the cost of collecting school taxes. House Bill 1094 by Representative Kaiser of the 59th, the bill relating to the public water systems. House Bill 1095 by Representative Chokas of the 138th, the bill relating to torts. House Bill 1096 by Representative Parsons of the 44th, the bill relating to disposition of unclaimed property. House Resolution 1508 by Representative Powell of the 171st, resolution honoring the life of Mr. Harvey J. Morey and dedicating a road in his memory. House Resolution 1509 by Representative Kidd of the 145th, resolution creating a House Study Committee on Ambulance Service Rates. House Resolution 1510 by Representative Kidd of the 145th, a resolution creating a House Durable Medical Equipment Study Committee. House Resolution 1511 by Representative Gordon of the 163rd, a resolution creating the Joint Study Committee on New Market Tax Credits in Georgia. House Resolution 1512 by Representative Willard of the 51st, a resolution honoring the life of Mayor Eva Cohn Galambos and dedicating an interchange in her memory. House Resolution 1513 by Representative Evans of the 42nd, a resolution creating the House Study Committee on Civil Rights. House Resolution 1523 by Representative Ralston of the 7th, a resolution honoring the life of Sergeant First Class Ray F. Lentz and dedicating an intersection in his memory. House Resolution 1524 by Representative Ralston of the 7th, a resolution honoring the life of Mayor Barbara Stevens, dedicating a road in her memory. House Resolution 1525 by Representative Ralston of the 7th, a resolution honoring the life of Mr. Roy L. Chapman and dedicating an intersection in his memory. Senate Bill 312 by Senator Bethel of the 54th, bill relating to Hope Scholarships and Grants. Senate Bill 350 by Senator Mollis of the 53rd, a bill relating to taxation of consumer fireworks. Senate Resolution 558 by Senator Mollis of the 53rd, resolution proposing amendments to the Constitution so as to provide that the proceeds of excise taxes on the sale of fireworks in the state be dedicated to the funding of trauma care, fire services, burn treatment, and local public safety purposes in the state of Georgia, through second readers.
Reports of standing committees. The clerk will read.
Representative Jan Tankersley, the 160th District, Chairman of the Committee on Intergovernmental Coordination, submitted the following report. Mr. Speaker, your Committee on Intergovernmental Coordination has set under consideration the following bills of the House, and has instructed me to report the same back to the House with the following recommendations. House Bill 1056, do pass. House Bill 1067, do pass. House Bill 1074, do pass. House Bill 1081, do pass. House Bill 1082, do pass. House Bill 1083, do pass. House Bill 1002, do pass. Respectfully submitted, Representative Jan Tankersley, Chairman. Representative Coomer of the 14th District, Chairman of the Committee of Transportation, submitted the following report. Mr. Speaker, your Committee on Transportation has set under consideration the following resolution of the House. This instructed me to report the same back to the House with the following recommendations. House Resolution 1052, due pass by committee substitute. Respectfully submitted, Representative Coomer, Chairman. That completes the reports of standing committees.
All right, we're going on now to third reading and passage of uncontested local bills. We're going on to the local calendar. If there is no objection, we will vote on the local calendar as a whole with a recorded vote. Hearing none, it is so ordered. The clerk will read the local calendar.
House Bill 1002 by Representative Flood of the 64th, Clayton and Fulton Counties. House Bill 1056 by Representative Jaspers of the 11th, Pickens County. House Bill 1067 by Representative Rhodes of the 120th, Greene County. House Bill 1074 by Representative Reeds of the 34th, Cobb County. House Bill 1081 by Representative Williamson of the 115th, Walton County. House Bill 1082 by Representative Greene of the 151st, Early County. House Bill 1083 by Representative Houston of the 170th, Tiff County. That completes the reading of the local calendar.
Is there any objection to the previous question being ordered on the local calendar? The chair hears none. The previous question is ordered. Is there any objection to agreeing to the report of the committee, which was favorable to the passage of the bills? The chair hears none. The report of the committee is agreed to. Shall the bills on the local calendar now pass? All those in favor of the passage of the bills on the local calendar will vote aye. Those opposed will vote no, and the clerk will unlock the machines. Have all members voted? Have all members voted? If so, the clerk will lock the machine on the passage of the bills on the local calendar. The ayes are 153. The nays are zero. These bills, having received the requisite constitutional majority, are therefore passed. We're going on now to morning orders. Morning orders. Chair recognizes Representative Coach Williams for a morning order.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Member of the House, I will be doing the Black History Moment. Above, members of the Georgia House, a representative refused to seat 26-year-old Horace Julian Bond because of his stand against the Vietnam War in 1966. The U.S. Supreme Court ruled that they had violated his freedom of speech, and Bond was allowed to take his seat. I knew Representative Bond personally because I was his driver when he came to St. Petersburg, Florida, to speak to my political group. Black history, it's not just our history, it's American history. Moments in Black history that changed America. 1619, the first Americans are brought to the British colony in America called Jamestown, Virginia. 1776, the United States of America is founded. 1863, President Lincoln signed the Emancipation Proclamation to free Southern slaves. 1870, the first American is elected to Congress, Joseph Haynes Rainey. 1947, Jackie Robinson became the first Black player in Major League Baseball. 1955, the arrest of Rosa Parks inspired the Montgomery bus boycott and the Civil Rights Movement. 1964, the Civil Rights Act banned discrimination of all kinds based on race, color, religion, and national origin. 1968, the first Black woman is elected to Congress, Shirley Chisholm. 2008, President Hussein Obama became the first Black U.S. president. That's your moment in Black history that changed America. Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and I yield the well.
Chair recognizes Chairman David Knight for a morning order. Chairman Knight.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Ladies and gentlemen, of the Sportsman's Caucus, and for those who are not in the Sportsman's Caucus, be a great time to join up, by the way. But as you know, the Sportsman's Caucus does not collect dues. Instead, we rely on a raffle as a way of raising the money in lieu of the dues. The rifles and the shotguns were generously 100% donated from Browning through the National Assembly of Sportsmen's Caucuses, of which we are a member. And therefore, 100% of what we raise through this raffle goes to our caucus. The winner will get to pick from one gun available from three. And let me tell you, you're about to get The pages are about to pass out, the raffle sheet, so don't throw them away. Look at them. So winner gets to choose from three guns. Second place will get a $100 Bass Pro Shop gift card. The raffle is limited to legislators only. So our Senate and House, okay? And there's going to be 200 tickets sold. That's it, 200 tickets sold. And so we will. You don't have to be present to win. Just write your name on the back of the ticket, and we will do the raffle as soon as 200 tickets are sold, or sine die, whatever comes first. And I want to thank a special thanks to Chairman Ron Stevens. Chairman Stevens, he's over there talking. Chairman Stevens won the raffle last year, and he was very generous, and he donated the rifle back to the caucus to re-raffle this year. So thank you, Chairman Stevens, for doing that. But I want to encourage you to look at this, and if you want to come buy raffle tickets, come by and see me, and we're going to try to get these sold as soon as possible. Thank you.
Chair recognizes Chairman Richard Smith for a morning order. Chairman Smith.
I'm not raffling off anything, Mr. Speaker. Thank you, Mr. Speaker. If any of y'all who have a community health center in your district, you're welcome to come down and join me, because today is Community Health Center Day at the Capitol. In Georgia, we're fortunate to have 34 organizations, 197 clinics, provide service to over 500,000 of our citizens. These community health centers and our member association, they serve the uninsured and the underinsured, and many of our areas are a large provider of members' state health benefit plan. I think they're in the gallery. If they would please, y'all please stand, and let us give y'all a warm welcome, because folks, this group is essential to the health of our communities. Thank y'all.
Did you get us?
You got to get the picture right.
Oh, okay. Come on. Let's hurry up. Okay.
Just for a minute.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Chair recognizes Representative Erica Thomas for a morning order.
Thank
Joined
you,
Joined by Representative Sharper.
Thank you, Speaker. We also have some other under 40 and under 50 representatives coming up. Thank you. Just come on up. Okay, we got under 60 coming up. Come on up. Good. All right. Well, today I am so excited to be recognizing a group of phenomenal individuals. We have the Urban League Young Professionals and the National MBA Association. These young professionals do so much in our community. We have lawyers, we have doctors, we have hopefully future politicians after today. But I would love for you to stand, please stand, and recognize this group and give them a round of applause, please. And also today, we have a pillar in the community, a woman that I consider a game changer, Miss Shakina Farr Moore. She helps youth, and she's a women activist. She helps young women with her. She's the founder of B2F Girls, a nationwide training and certification resource for women who mentor girls. Let's give Miss Farr a round of applause. Thank you so much for all that you do. And they also have a really nice horse farm. So if you would like to ride some horses, visit Ms. Farr. She'll let you ride a couple horses one day. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
All right, we're going on to the rules calendar. We're going on to the rules calendar. All right, here's the position we're in. We have a number of measures on the rules calendar. There's a rumor going around that there's going to be a supplemental rules calendar. I haven't confirmed that. And it is Friday, but it is also day 29. The chair is going to ask for your cooperation today that we can move through this calendar efficiently but thoroughly. That doesn't include me having to go to the gavel to get your attention so that people can hear the presentations being made. But I will. The clerk will read the caption to House Bill 749.
House Bill 749 by Representative Werkheiser of the 157th and others, be titled an act to amend Code Section 50-8-34 of the Official Code of Georgia annotated relating to councils of regional commissions, membership, terms of membership, voting, officers, and powers so as to authorize such councils to meet by teleconference or similar means. This bill having been referred to the Committee on State Planning and Community Affairs, that committee recommends that this bill do pass.
Chair recognizes Representative Werkheiser to present the bill.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I bring before you today House Bill 749. It merely allows regional commissions the same privilege that state boards have under the open meetings law, that we allow them the use of telecommunications as a tool. And I'll be glad to stand for a couple of questions.
You have no questions.
Thank you. I ask for your favorable consideration for 749. Thank you.
Chair recognizes Representative Turner to speak to the bill. Going once, three times. Is there any objection to the previous question being ordered? The chair hears none. The previous question is ordered. Is there any objection to agreeing to the report of the committee, which was favorable to the passage of the bill? The chair hears none. The report of the committee is agreed to. Shall this bill now pass? All those in favor of the passage of House Bill 749 will vote aye. Those opposed will vote no, and the clerk will unlock the machines. Have all members voted? Have all members voted? If so, the clerk will lock the machine on the passage of House Bill 749. The ayes are 152, the nays are zero. This bill, having received the requisite constitutional majority, is therefore passed. Clerk will read the caption to House Bill 1084. House Bill 1084.
House Bill 1084 by Representative Houston of the 170th to be titled an act to amend Code Section 2-6-27 of the Official Code of Georgia annotated relating to additional duties and powers of the State Soil and Water Conservation Commission. This bill has been referred to the Committee on Appropriations. That committee recommends that this bill do pass.
Chair recognizes Chairman Houston to present the bill.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I bring before you today House Bill 1084. This legislation amends code sections to assign the process of reading, maintaining, and management of all aspects of the agricultural water meeting program to the Georgia Forestry Commission. Presently, the Georgia Forestry Commission is already reading 3/4 of the meters.
You have no questions.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I yield the floor.
Is there any objection to the previous question being ordered? The chair hears none. The previous question is ordered. Is there any objection to agreeing to the report of the committee, which was favorable to the passage of the bill? The chair hears none. The report of the committee is agreed to. Shall this bill now pass? All those in favor of the passage of House Bill 1084 will vote aye. All those opposed will vote no, and the clerk will unlock the machines. Have all members voted? Have all members voted? If so, the clerk will lock the machines on the passage of House Bill 1084. The ayes are 150. The nays are 5. This bill, having received the requisite constitutional majority, is therefore passed. Clerk will read the caption to House Bill 893.
House Bill 893 by Representative Powell of the 171st and others to be entitled an act to amend Article 2 of Chapter 2 of Title 48 of the Official Code of Georgia annotated relating to administration of revenue and taxation so as to change certain provisions regarding forms of payment. This bill having referred to the Committee on Ways and Means, that committee recommends that this bill do pass.
Chair recognizes the Chairman of the Ways and Means Committee, Chairman Powell, to present the bill.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Ladies and gentlemen of the House, this is House Bill 893. Approximately 6 or 7 years ago, we started requiring our taxpayers who file sales tax returns and other returns to file electronically if they had a threshold of $1,000 or more in tax liability. And then the year after that, we went down to a $500 threshold. And what we're doing is continuing that process. We've given everybody an opportunity of about 6 or 7 years to adjust to that and allow more people to get onto the internet, to get computers, and to get computer software and computer savvy. And so this bill follows the trend that we started 7 years ago and reduces the threshold further to $250 beginning in 2017, followed a year later to a threshold of $100. The benefits of this are twofold. Number one, it'll save the state, after it's ultimately completed, approximately $250,000, $260,000 a year in paper and clerical cost. The other things it will do is it will improve the efficiency of the Department of Revenue, because right now for those returns that are filed on paper, they have to key those in manually into their system. So there's an opportunity for things to be incorrectly keyed in, which then takes more time and staff time to correct. So this will improve efficiency and save money. Mr. Speaker, if there are no questions, I will yield the
will. You have a question if you care to yield.
I'll yield for one.
Chair recognizes Coach Williams to your right for a question. He waves.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I yield.
Is there any objection to the previous question being ordered? The chair hears none. The previous question is ordered. Is there any objection to agreeing to the report of the committee, which was favorable to the passage of the bill? The chair hears none. The report of the committee is agreed to. Shall this bill now pass? All those in favor of the passage of House Bill 893 will vote aye. All those opposed will vote no, and the clerk will unlock the machines. Have all members voted? Have all members voted? If so, the clerk will lock the machine on the passage of House Bill 893. The ayes are 155, the nays are 0. This bill, having received the requisite constitutional majority, is therefore passed. Clerk will read the caption to House Bill 979.
House Bill 979 by Representative Caldwell of the 131st and others to be entitled an act to amend Article 2 of Chapter 5, Title 16 of the Official Code of Georgia annotated relating to assault and battery and related offenses against persons. This bill having referred to the committee, Judiciary Non-Civil, that committee recommends that this bill do pass.
Chair recognizes Representative Caldwell to present the bill.
Mr. Speaker, ladies and gentlemen, you have before you House Bill 979, and I know there's probably going to be some questions, so let me give you a little bit of background on this bill and why I have brought it. In 2014, this House, along with the Senate, had a joint study committee concerning health care workers and assaults that are committed on them, particularly health care workers in the emergency rooms, or known as the EDs, and the EMS and EMT people that are picking up people on the road or for whatever purposes in ambulances and bringing them to the hospitals. That committee found that some 70% of all emergency room nurses or emergency room personnel are attacked in some way by either the patient they are picking up, but usually, or by more often, it's by the people who are then coming to the hospital, friends or families, or sometimes even people who don't like that person when you've had some type of altercation, and the nurses and EMT personnel are attacked. This does not create any new law. Georgia law on aggravated assault is OCGA 16-5-21. It already provides that if you commit an aggravated assault against an individual and you're convicted of that, the penalty is 1 to 20 years in the penitentiary. That's current law. Current law also says that if you commit that aggravated assault on a police officer and are convicted, it's 5 to 20 years, not 1 to 20, but 5. The same if you commit it to a correctional officer who's working in a correctional institute. If you commit that aggravated assault in a transit vehicle, if you're on MARTA bus or a train, and you commit an aggravated assault and you're convicted, it carries 5 to 20 years. And it looks like somebody has already assaulted me today. But if an aggravated assault were committed against me and that person was convicted because I'm 65 years of age or older, actually I'm 69, then the penalty is 5 to 20 years. So this is not creating any new law. All it does is we're saying now, just like with police officers, correctional institute people, people that commit it while in a transit, spouses who commit aggravated assaults against one another, or even parents of the same children who are convicted of aggravated assault, it's 5 to 20. All I'm doing, it doesn't create new law, it doesn't create new procedure, it doesn't create any new evidence. It's exactly the same. We're going to give these health care workers in the emergency room, just like police officers and old people like me, if they have an aggravated assault, it's 5 to 20 years. Instead of 1 to 20, but also you can still get probation. It can also still be reduced just like any other aggravated assault penalty. So with that, Mr. Speaker, I stand for any questions.
You do have some questions.
I will yield.
Chair recognizes Chairman Welch to your left for a question.
Does the gentleman yield?
Yes, sir.
It's not true that you had served a judge in your former life.
Yes, sir, and district attorney for 15 years before that.
Yes, sir. Would you mind just explaining exactly what an aggravated assault is and why we have the elevated sentence we do?
All right, thank you very much. Ladies and gentlemen, aggravated assault, well, first, let's say there's two types of assault. There's simple and there's aggravated. Simple assault is when I threaten you, I don't touch you, I don't have a weapon in my hand, but I make some type of threatening move towards you that puts you in fear of receiving an injury. Aggravated assault means that I assault you with the intent to murder, rape, or rob, or with a deadly weapon. If I point a gun at you, even though I know it won't shoot, it has no bullets, it doesn't even have a firing pin, but you don't know that, and you think I'm going to shoot you and I put you in fear of receiving a violent injury and or death, I have committed an aggravated assault. Aggravated assault also can be committed by strangulation. That's a new provision that was put in the code about 10 years ago. I say new for me because I'm so old. That also is part of aggravated assault. but you don't actually have to even touch the person. Most of the time they are touched, but you don't have to commit an aggravated assault. This also goes to aggravated battery. What's aggravated battery? Simple battery is an unpermitted touching of another person. Literally, if I touch the majority leader without his permission, and certainly in some violent way, or think I'm going to, that is a simple battery. But if I then injure him, maim any part of his body, or cause him to lose the use of some part of his body, it is an aggravated battery, and it carries 1 to 20 years. Likewise, if that is committed on somebody 65 years or older, a police officer, a transit worker, a correctional officer, it moves from 5 to 20 years, and that's all we're doing. And thank you for the question, Chairman Welch.
Chair recognizes Chairman Coomer to your right for a question.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Gentleman yield.
Yes, sir.
Just two questions. One, I notice you have a black eye.
Yes, sir.
Is that related to your research on this bill?
No, it's related to my wife told me to shut up and I stood up.
And the second question, the second question is, just to clarify for some folks who may have a misunderstanding, there are no mandatory minimum prison terms in this bill. Is that correct?
No, none whatsoever.
Thank you.
Do you yield for further questions?
Yes, Mr. Speaker.
Chair recognizes Chairman Rogers to your right for a question.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Gentleman yield.
Yes, sir.
Judge, on line 15, where it says person, is a patient considered a person?
Not under this, because if you go on and read further, the definition says that it's a health care worker. Now, a person that commits it could be a patient, and sometimes it is. But please understand that a patient who is, of course, under sedation or something of that nature, this wouldn't affect them at all. It wouldn't affect somebody that's mentally ill. But a person who is voluntarily intoxicated or voluntarily intoxicated on alcohol and or drugs, yes, it would affect them, because that's no defense to a crime anyway, today, tomorrow, or any other time.
Further yield.
Yes, sir.
So, hypothetical, if I'm on a gurney and I'm intoxicated or on drugs, and the nurse comes in to see me 5 different times, and I kick her 5 different times or hit her 5 different times, I could be charged for five assaults. Isn't that true?
Well, you might could be charged. First, you said kick or push. That would be a simple battery, not under aggravated assault to aggravated assault under this. No, because what the court is going to do, because it's all within one sequence, they're going to merge all of those together. I've been there and done that for 43 years, so they're not going to charge him 5 different times. Okay. Now, if there's a long time elapsed, they could be the next day. But if it's all in one sequence, no.
Further yield.
Yes, sir.
So our sequence would be defined as 6 hours in an emergency room or 8 hours in an emergency room or 3 hours?
That would be up to the prosecutor of each individual area as to what they're going to say. It has some a lapse of time to some extent. Yes, sir.
Further yield, one more.
Yes, sir.
If I were in there and had an allergic reaction to a drug, would that still be considered an assault if I reacted to the...
No, sir, because you're then under the reaction of a drug they gave you. It was not voluntary on your part. They were treating you.
Okay.
Voluntary intoxication means I drank a gallon of Jack Daniel before I went in there, or I had used my own drugs and I got in there, and then I started swinging at people and stabbing them. And most of the nurses are even stabbed with knives, they're shot at with guns, and they're even stabbed with hypodermic needles, and a lot of them even in the neck. That would be.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Yes, sir. Mr. Speaker, unless there's not any more questions, I yield away.
You further yield?
I would like to yield the well, Mr. Speaker.
Well, you certainly can do that.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Gentleman has yielded the will. Is there any objection to the previous question being ordered? The chair hears none. The previous question is ordered. Is there any objection to agreeing to the report of the committee, which was favorable to the passage of the bill? The chair hears none. The report of the committee is agreed to. Shall this bill now pass? All those in favor of the passage of House Bill 979 will vote aye. Those opposed will vote no, and the clerk will unlock the machines. Have all members voted? Have all members voted? If so, the clerk will lock the machine on the passage of House Bill 979. The ayes are 147, the nays are 6. This bill, having received the requisite constitutional majority, is therefore passed. Clerk will read the caption to House Bill 959.
House Bill 959 by Representative Beskin of the 54th and others to be titled an act to amend Title 20 of the Official Code of Georgia annotated relating to education so as to update and clarify certain provisions relating to K-12 education. This bill having referred to the Committee on Education, that committee recommends that this bill do pass by committee substitute.
Chair recognizes Representative Beskin to present the bill.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Today I bring you House Bill 959, which includes the annual revisions to the Title 20 education statute. It does several things. It clarifies three types of activities that school board members can do without violating their ethical constraints. It provides that a student who is enrolled in a dual enrollment program through Move On When Ready, who makes a grade of A, B, or C in that post-secondary education course, does not need to return to his or her high school to take an end-of-course assessment. It provides that the Department of Education and GOSA, the Governor's Office of Student Achievement, can share data for purposes of evaluating programs, which will allow the Department of Education to administer the Georgia Awards Program. And finally, it eliminates a provision so that the Georgia Public Education Foundation can acquire or hold title to real property. This is a specific, this specific revision is necessary because a donor has made a specific bequest of real property that they would like to benefit the Georgia Honors Program, but unless this provision is repealed, it cannot accept that donation. GHP intends to acquire this real property, the title to it, and sell the property, and does not intend to hold the property. So with that, Mr. Speaker, I would be happy to answer any questions.
You don't appear to have any questions.
Thank you. Then I will yield the will.
Is there any objection to the previous question being ordered? The chair hears none. The previous question is ordered. Is there any objection to adopting the committee substitute? The chair hears none. The committee substitute is adopted. Is there any objection to agreeing to the report of the committee, which was favorable to the passage of the bill? The chair hears none. The report of the committee is agreed to. Shall this bill now pass? All those in favor of the passage of House Bill 959 will vote aye. All those opposed will vote no, and the clerk will unlock the machines. Have all members voted? Have all members voted? If so, the clerk will lock the machine on the passage of House Bill 959. The ayes are 157, the nays are 0. This bill, having received the requisite constitutional majority, is therefore passed. Clerk will read the caption to House Bill 962.
House Bill 962 by Representative Abrams of the 89th and others to be titled an act to amend Article 1 of Chapter 2 of Title 49 of the Official Code of Georgia annotated relating to the Department of Human Services generally so as to provide for the creation, appointment, removal, and duties of a kinship care enforcement administrator. This bill has been referred to the Committee of Juvenile Justice. That committee recommends that this bill do pass by committee substitute.
Chair recognizes the Minority Leader of the House, Leader Abrams, to present the bill.
Mr. Speaker,
Today I bring forward HB 962, which has the very simple proposition of creating a kinship care enforcement administrator within the Department of Family and Children's Services. By way of background, I want to first thank Governor Deal, Commissioner Bobby Cagle, and the members of the Kinship Care Study Committee. We traveled around the state last year, and certainly the speaker for authorizing the study committee. We traveled around the state. We went to Dalton, Albany, Savannah, Atlanta. We took hundreds of testimonials online, and what we found again and again is that Georgia is leading the nation, especially in the Southeast, for kinship care families. A kinship care family is important to understand because we have two systems. We have the public care of children who cannot be raised by their parents that we call foster care. And within that system, we will put children into relative care placement, but that's roughly about 2,000 children a year. We have about 15,000 children who are actually in foster care at any given moment. But kinship care is the private, informal system that we have. And in that system, we have between 100 and 300,000 children in the state of Georgia who are being raised by people who are not their parents. Most typically, those are grandparents raising grandchildren. Often it is aunts, uncles, or fictive kin, which are close family friends. Georgia's population is growing very quickly, driven in no small part by the drug epidemic that we have and by our military population, but also simply by the size of our state. Over time, we've created a patchwork of systems that support these families, but the challenge now is to find a way to integrate that support and make certain that these families are getting access to the services that they need. The complaints that we heard throughout the testimony and that were informed also by DFACS are that there's a failure to be able to explain the available assistance to kinship care families. They don't understand their options. If they're a grandparent, they are actually pushed between two different agencies, DFACS and the Division of Aging Services. There are fundings that come from both the state and the federal government that sit in these two different divisions. They were often not aware of specific Georgia TANF programs available to the children in their care, and there was a failure to timely process paperwork. In conversation with Commissioner Cagle, what we recommend and what this bill would do is create an enforcement administrator position within DFACS. That person would monitor and ensure continual compliance with all existing and future policies related to kinship care families. In HB 751, in our budget for this upcoming fiscal year, we added 10 new kinship care navigators to bring it to a total of 25. This person would be responsible for monitoring those navigators and making certain that they have the information and the support they need to serve this vast population in the state of Georgia. What this bill does not do is create any new fiscal obligation for the state. Commissioner Cagle is going to take existing resources and reorganize them to provide funding for this position. So this is not a change to how we fund the state. It is a change to how we do the job that we already have, which is supporting these families. This is an incredibly important issue. This is a change that we need to make, and I would ask this body's favorable consideration. Mr. Speaker, I'm happy to yield for any questions.
You do not have any questions.
Then I ask this body's favorable consideration. Thank you, and I yield the will.
Chair recognizes Chairman Dempsey to speak to the bill.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and good morning. I'm going to speak from my heart to you. I'm sure that many of you here in your communities about the challenge of the number of children that are now in DFACS care that are placed in homes that they move around in a bit. They're placed in congregate living at times, and they're placed out of county. I particularly have the largest number, not only of foster children in our state, but the largest number placed out of county. So I'm going to tell you that this challenge is very close to my heart because of that, first of all, but secondly, because it fulfills part of the budget responsibilities that I've been entrusted with, and I thank you for that. I thank Leader Abrams for this. The study committee was a very powerful tool to begin to really talk about this next step that we need to do. For children are always in a better situation if they are raised with a family member. If that opportunity can be found to find a relative, it might be a grandparent, it might be an aunt or an uncle, it might be fictive kin, and some of us don't always know what that word means, but someone who is so close to the family that they are like a relative. I'm sure each of you have people that you call aunt or uncle, and they're not actually your aunt or uncle or your cousin, but they're so close. What a great opportunity for children to be moved into a situation like that, and then to also know their other relatives with that security that one day if something happened and there was another move, they might be transferred into another relative's home rather than starting all over and going back through the process. As we do this, though, it's hard. The main thing you probably hear from those in your community are that it's hard to navigate the system. They feel like they can't get answers. They don't know if there's funding. Whether they're a grandparent or just a foster parent, it is a huge challenge that we have. So to really laser focus in on this opportunity right now that we have, and to make sure that those who are willing to take a family member in and to raise that child with all the love and kindness that exists, there are financial challenges. There are medical challenges. How do we get to the records? How do we make sure that this child is continuing on in school as they should be? To have that support, to make it as easy as possible for them to do that work. That's what this bill is about, to create that enforcement administrator that will pull all of our new kinship navigators, increasing it, you voted to increase it to 25, a total of 25, with our great House budget this year. It does not require one bit more funding today. We are asking you to help maximize this potential today, and I ask for your positive support on this measure. Mr. Speaker, if there are any questions, I'll be glad to take them. If not, I will yield the well.
You have a couple of questions if you care to yield.
I do.
Chair recognizes Chairman Weldon to your left for a question.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Will the lady yield?
I certainly will.
Thank you. Isn't it true this bill went through the Juvenile Justice Committee?
I'm sure you know of what you speak.
And he came out with a due pass recommendation to the rules and all.
And the gentleman does know of what he speaks.
And this bill is financially responsible, and it also provides support for the kinship care of children that otherwise could be left to the state to support and care for and provide for.
That is a fact.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Do you further yield?
I do.
Chair recognizes Representative Teasley to your right for a question.
Does the lady yield?
I do.
To my seatmate, isn't it true that I spent some time in years past mentoring youth and went through the experience of seeing particularly a number of young men be in homes where they didn't have their dad or they didn't have their mom? And it's important that we stand up and we do something to help these children get the direction that they need.
The gentleman knows of what he speaks.
Isn't it also true that I'm very grateful for your work and Leader Abrams' work on this bill?
Thank you, and it is a privilege to be a part of it.
No further questions.
I will yield the will then and ask for your favorable support.
Is there any objection to the previous question being ordered? The chair hears none. The previous question is ordered. Is there any objection to adopting the committee substitute? The chair hears none. The committee substitute is adopted. Is there any objection to agreeing to the report of the committee, which was favorable to the passage of the bill? The chair hears none. The report of the committee is agreed to. Shall this bill now pass? All those in favor of the passage of House Bill 962 will vote aye. All those opposed will vote no, and the clerk will unlock the machines. Have all members voted? Have all members voted? If so, the clerk will lock the machine on the passage of House Bill 962. The ayes are 160, the nays are zero. This bill, having received the requisite constitutional majority, is therefore passed. Clerk will read the caption to House Bill 1085, House Bill 1085.
House Bill 1085 by Representative Dempsey, the 13th, to be titled an Act to amend Chapter 6 and Title 49 of the Fiscal Code of Georgia annotated relating to services for the aging, so as to transfer the oversight of such services to the Department of Community Health. This bill had been referred to the Committee on Appropriations. That committee recommends that this bill do pass.
Chair recognizes Chairman Dempsey to present the bill.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and thank you all for that great vote that you just cast. I've got another measure that I want to bring to you. It is truly a simple measure. We say that, I know, and you often sort of chuckle when you do. But truly this designates that the Department of Community Health will be the administrator of Community Care Services, CCSP. As we traveled through the budget this year, many of you probably heard from people who were concerned in your district about the CCSP waivers. This will align the federal funding with the state services. We have previously had CCSP dollars that were coming from our federal government into DCH and then moved over to DHS for the service delivery. This will take it straight into the Department of Community Health and allow for those services to be closer to where they can actually do the best that they can do for our elderly population. The administration of the program must be statutorily transferred. We did this in the budget already, that great budget I was speaking of that each of you have already voted on and passed. So it is there, and we need your support on this. The source and CCPS waivers utilize waiver authority that the elderly population in your community need. If there are any questions, I'll be glad to take them, Mr. Speaker. If not, I will yield the well.
You have no questions.
Thank you. I ask for your favorable support.
Is there any objection to the previous question being ordered? The chair hears none. The previous question is ordered. Is there any objection to agreeing to the report of the committee, which was favorable to the passage of the bill? The chair hears none. The report of the committee is agreed to. Shall this bill now pass? All those in favor of the passage of House Bill 1085 will vote aye. All those opposed will vote no, and the clerk will unlock the machine. Have all members voted? Have all members voted? If so, the clerk will lock the machine on the passage of House Bill 1085. The ayes are 158, the nays are zero. This bill, having received the requisite constitutional majority, is therefore passed. Clerk will read the caption to House Bill 498.
House Bill 498 by Representative Hawkins, the 27th and others, being titled an act to amend Code Section 43-10A-3 of the Official Code of Georgia annotated relating the definitions relative to professional counselors. This bill having been referred to the Committee on Regulated Industries, that committee recommends that this bill do pass by committee substitute.
Chair recognizes Representative Hawkins to present the bill.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Today I bring you House Bill 498. There are two parts to this bill and two objectives in this bill. First is to insert the word diagnosis into the LPC, Licensed Professional Counselors, section of the law. And let me address that first. Diagnosis is important in this day and age with healthcare. If you cannot diagnose, then you can logically not treat. So this is about, and I've heard this mentioned in the halls, this is about money to LPCs. This is about money to the patients. Because if the insurance denies payment, you, the patient, are going to be required to pay. So this is about our folks and our hometowns being helped with this. The second part of the bill is about testing, and it defines testing very well. It says that testing, psychological testing, is for organic brain or accidental trauma or neurophysiological orders. So this is in the purview of a PhD psychologist, and that is what this addresses. And that is all. I yield the will for questions.
You do have some questions if you care to yield. It's up to you.
Been advised I need to take a few.
Chair recognizes Chairman Dixon to your left for a question.
The gentleman yield?
I yield.
Is it not true that the licensed professional counselors group has agreed, as well as the psychologist group?
That is true. As you well know, I need to recognize Chairman Tom Dixon. For the last 3 weeks, he has actually worked with both these groups tirelessly, where some of us found difficulty. Chairman Dixon found solutions.
Is it also not further true that this bill will not prevent licensed professional counselors from using basically all of the tests that they have previously used?
Exactly. That is exactly correct.
I think it's a good bill. Appreciate your work.
Thank you.
Do you further yield?
Let's do one more.
Chair recognizes Representative Chandler to your left for a question.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Does the gentleman yield?
Yes, ma'am.
Is it not true that I am a former LPC and I support adding diagnosed to the scope of practice for the LPCs?
Yes, ma'am.
And that I further support the psychologist because I know that they are the ones that have the education and the training to do psychological testing.
Yes, ma'am, you sure do. And I need to also acknowledge Representative Chandler for all her work on this bill. Without her, this would not have come to fruition. I yield the will.
Gentleman has yielded the will. Is there any objection to the previous question being ordered? The chair hears none. The previous question is ordered. Is there any objection to adopting the committee substitute? The chair hears none. The committee substitute is adopted. Is there any objection to agreeing to the report of the committee, which was favorable to the passage of the bill? The chair hears none. The report of the committee is agreed to. Shall this bill now pass? All those in favor of the passage of House Bill 498 will vote aye. Those opposed will vote no, and the clerk will unlock the machines. Have all members voted? Have all members voted? If so, the clerk will lock the machine on the passage of House Bill 498. The ayes are 150. The nays are 4. This bill, having received the requisite constitutional majority, is therefore passed. The clerk will read the caption to House Bill 508.
House Bill 508 by Representative Fleming of the 121st and others being titled amend Code Section 47-2-244, the Fiscal Code of Georgia annotated, relating the optional benefits available to appellate court judges. This bill having been referred to the Committee on Retirement. That committee recommends that this bill do pass.
Chair recognizes Representative Fleming to present the bill.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Ladies and gentlemen of the House, I bring to you House Bill 508. House Bill 508 does deal with our judicial retirement system. Currently, about 95% of our state-level judges retire or are eligible to retire at age 60. All this bill does is make our appellate judges into that same category that they can retire at age 60 rather than age 65. The retirement system for our judges has always been a good draw to bring in the best and the brightest. It continues to do that. Some of our recent appointees have been younger. And this has helped, I believe, attract some of the best folks into the position of being a judge. There is an appropriation required for this, and we have been working with the chairman of the Appropriations Committee, and he's assured us that if we pass this bill, that money will be available. That's simply what it does, Mr. Speaker, and I would be happy to answer any questions any members of the House may have.
You do not have any questions.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I yield the will.
Is there any objection to the previous question being ordered? The chair hears none. The previous question is ordered. Is there any objection to agreeing to the report of the committee, which was favorable to the passage of the bill? The chair hears none. The report of the committee is agreed to. Shall this bill now pass? All those in favor of the passage of House Bill 508 will vote aye. Those opposed will vote no, and the clerk will unlock the machines. Have all members voted? Have all members voted? If so, the clerk will lock the machines on the passage of House Bill 508, the ayes are 141, the nays are 12. This bill, having received the requisite constitutional majority, is therefore passed. Clerk will read the caption to House Bill 899. House Bill 899.
House Bill 899 by Representative Powell, the 171st and others, to be entitled an act to amend chapters 13 and 13A of Title 10 of the Official Code of Georgia annotated relating to tobacco product manufacturers and master settlement agreement enhancements so as to revise and add certain definitions. This bill having referred to the Committee on Ways and Means, that committee recommends that this bill do pass by committee substitute.
Chair recognizes Chairman Powell to present the bill.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. This is House Bill 899. For background information, in approximately 1998, the state of Georgia and 47 other states settled with the major tobacco companies in this country in the Master Tobacco Settlement. And as a result of that, these settling companies pay to the various states tobacco settlement money, from which we receive approximately $150 million a year. Part of the settlement required that non-settling companies had to pay into an escrow account, and the purpose of this was to level the playing field so that the non-settling companies did not have a competitive advantage over the settling companies. In 2012, the state of Georgia signed a settlement agreement that resolved some issues that had arisen under the master settlement agreement, specifically dealing with these escrow accounts, because the escrow accounts were not being collected or enforced like they were supposed to. There was the possibility that the settling companies would not have to pay what they had obligated themselves to pay because we were not enforcing the escrow like we were supposed to. In states that they have litigated this matter, they have had reductions in the amount paid by the settling companies of up to 50%. If that were to happen in the state of Georgia, it could reduce the amount that we receive every year by approximately $75 million. So the purpose of this bill is to tighten up the escrow requirements of current law so that we make sure that the non-settling companies pay and are required to pay the amount that the master settlement agreement requires them to pay. Mr. Speaker, it's kind of a complicated issue, but that is basically the crux of it, and I'll be happy to answer any questions.
You do have a question if you care to yield.
Yes, sir, I'll yield for one.
Chair recognizes Chairman Chokas to your left for a question.
Does the chairman yield?
Yes, sir.
Who enforces the collection from the non-master settlement companies?
State that again.
Who enforces the collection? Is that through the Department of Revenue, or is there another agency?
The Department of Revenue can enforce the collection, but it is paid into an escrow agent.
And who has been responsible for paying in the past that money? For collecting on that money?
Well, it's always been paid to an escrow agent. It was the fact that there were not specific requirements in the law to enforce that payment and to actually define who is to pay and when they're to pay and how you enforce that payment.
Thank you.
Mr. Speaker, I'll yield to Will.
You have one more question if you care to yield.
Yes, sir, I'll yield.
Chair recognizes Chairman Lynn Smith to your right for a question.
Thank you,
down
Mr.
the
Chairman.
Middle.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. In your line of sight, straight down. Good morning. Do you yield?
Yes, ma'am.
For the purpose of clarification, is there a sunset or a time limit on these tobacco funds? Is there a period of time when it runs out, and are there provisions for that?
Well, as far as the escrow provision, which is what we're looking at here, that if these companies that did not settle and are paying into the escrow account, if they are either not sued by the state or voluntarily come in under the settlement agreement within 25 years, then the escrow ceases. Mr. Speaker, I will yield the will.
Is there any objection to the previous question being ordered? The chair hears none. The previous question is ordered. Is there any objection to adopting the committee substitute? The chair hears none. The committee substitute is adopted. Is there any objection to agreeing to the report of the committee, which was favorable to the passage of the bill? The chair hears none. The report of the committee is agreed to. Shall this bill now pass? All those in favor of the passage of House Bill 899 will vote aye. Those opposed will vote no. And the clerk will unlock the machines. Have all members voted? Have all members voted? If so, the clerk will lock the machines. On the passage of House Bill 899, the ayes are 159, the nays are zero. This bill, having received the requisite constitutional majority, is therefore passed. Clerk will read the caption to House Bill 736.
House Bill 736 by Representative Atwood of the 179th and others to be entitled an act to amend Code Section 40-2-86 of the Official Code of Georgia Annotated relating to special license plates promoting certain beneficial projects and supporting certain worthy agencies. This bill having been referred to the Committee on Motor Vehicles, the committee recommends that this bill do pass by committee substitute.
Chair recognizes Representative Atwood to present the bill.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Ladies and gentlemen of the House, I bring for you favorable consideration for House Bill 736. This is our annual consolidated tag bill. I originally brought the bill to establish a special license plate promoting marine habitat down in our coastal area, providing funds to increase our fishing. But we also, for legislative economy, have added other bills to this legislation, which contains provisions for other special license plates for folks that are important to them. We have one for honoring our female veterans, also one for Omega Psi Phi fraternity, and one that's very special to me after serving 34 years active in reserve in the Marine Corps. It provides that a spouse of a veteran is eligible for a free veteran's tax as long as they do not remarry, and he or she can enjoy that benefit, and spouses are very, very important to our deploying military service members. So there is also a friendly amendment, I understand, to recognize Hampton University, which I do not object to. And with that, Mr. Speaker, I will answer questions if there are any.
You have no questions.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen of the House. I ask for your consideration.
Chair recognizes Representative Gilligan to speak in opposition to the bill.
Actually, I do not oppose the bill. I am going to vote in favor of this particular bill. I am a veteran, and if you can tell, I am not a male, so I am a female veteran. But that particular provision in this legislation is the one that causes me concern. During the time that I was a veteran, I had to work very hard to be thought of as an equal to my peer in my same rank. And when we have a tag like that, it just brings a concern. I want, hopefully, that when people see a female veteran tag, that they are not thinking of a second class of citizen, but a peer equal to all of the other veterans. So I will vote for this bill, but I wanted to speak to that one provision. And with that, I yield the well. Thank you.
Is there any objection to the previous question being ordered? The chair hears none. The previous question is ordered. There is an amendment offered to the bill. The clerk will read the amendment.
The amendment offered by Representative Rice, the 95th, Representative Flood of the 64th, offers the following amendment, AM 390153, which is printed and in your books.
Is there any objection to adopting the amendment, AM 390153? Is there objection? The chair hears none. The amendment is adopted. Is there any objection to adopting the committee substitute as amended? The chair hears none. The committee substitute as amended is adopted. Is there any objection to agreeing to the report of the committee, which was favorable to the passage of the bill? The chair hears none. The report of the committee is agreed to. Shall this bill now pass? All those in favor of the passage of House Bill 736 will vote aye. Those opposed will vote no, and the clerk will unlock the machines. Have all members voted? Have all members voted? If so, the clerk will lock the machines on the passage of House Bill 736. The ayes are 158, the nays are 1. This bill, having received the requisite constitutional majority, is therefore passed. Chair recognizes Representative Mosby to introduce the doctor of the day.
I could use him. Good morning. It is indeed my honor to introduce the doctor of the day. It is Dr. Earl Thurmond. He is an internist with Kaiser Permanente. He cares for adult patients throughout the metropolitan Atlanta area. He graduated from Georgia Tech, if you can believe that. Not UGA, not Georgia State. For us, Georgia State. Georgia, but we're not going to hold that against him. He graduated from Georgia Tech. He's a native of Augusta, and he completed his residency and his internal medicine degree from Howard University. But I know Dr. Thurmond as a board member at the Eastlake Y. We serve together. He's a great guy. He has a heart for the community. And ladies and gentlemen, I present to you the doctor of the day, Dr. Earl Thurmond.
Mr. Speaker, thank you. Good morning, everyone. I want to first thank you so much for your service every day and what you do for the state of Georgia. I want to let you know that this is truly an honor for me to be here. And if I can be of any help to any of you today, please come and see me. Thank you again.
Chair recognizes Representative Bentley and Representative Dickey for a morning order.
Happy Friday, colleagues. Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Representative Deacon, I was very proud to introduce to you a large group from Peach County Middle Elementary School. So, colleagues, I ask that you please join Representative Dickey and I and stand and welcome our group from Peach County to the Georgia State Capitol. We're so glad to have them here. Peach County. You want to say something?
Good job. No, that's fine. Yeah.
Thank you, Peach County. Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and thank you, colleagues.
Clerk will read the caption. Clerk will read the caption to House Bill 887. House Bill 887.
House Bill 887 by Representative Abstration of the 104th and others. And to be entitled an act to amend Article 3 and 4 of Chapter 11 of Title 15 of the Fish Code of Georgia annotated relating to dependency proceedings and termination of parental rights respectively so as to prioritize the placement of a child with a relative who was an adult. This bill had been referred to the Committee on Juvenile Justice. That committee recommends that this bill do pass by committee substitute.
Chair recognizes Representative F. Strachan to present the bill.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Ladies and gentlemen of the House, today it's my honor to bring before you House Bill 887. This legislation is important because it prioritizes the placement of children in DFACS care with a relative or fictive kin. And there are several important components that I'd ask you to take note of. First of all, this bill would maintain in statute that such a placement may only be made if it is in keeping with DFACS regulations and it's in the best interest of the child. And this maintains the priority that we have in placement to ensure that it's in the child's best interest while also recognizing the public policy purposes, appreciating that a placement with a relative or a close family friend is beneficial to the child. Now, you've heard a great deal about legislation already this session, including a bill today, sponsored by Leader Abrams, and with the work that's been provided through the study committee which she chaired, there's been some outstanding legislation proposed, and I thank Leader Abrams for her leadership on this issue. Also, I thank Representative Quick for working closely with me on this bill as we work through the legislative process. And I'm very proud to present it to you today with support from DFACS and having policy that is consistent with existing law and policy purposes that have been pursued in the past but weren't explicitly included in the juvenile code reform that this body took up several years ago. Should also mention that I worked in consultation with a juvenile court judge in my jurisdiction and greatly appreciate all the input that many members have brought to me. Just to address one issue that a member had talked with me about, if a child has had several years of placement with a foster parent and a relative then appears who maybe hasn't been part of that child's life, there's a concern expressed about that. And this bill explicitly includes a finding that the placement is in the child's best interest to alleviate that concern and that fear. And so I greatly appreciate all of the hard work that's been put forward on this bill. Fictive kin, as you've heard described earlier today, is a close family friend who maybe isn't related to the child by blood. But as Chairwoman Dempsey said, this would be somebody who's called aunt, godmother, godfather, something like that, who is acknowledged to be part of the child's life, and as you'll note in the bill, with whom the child has lived or has other significant contact. And so I'd submit that this is a very good bill. It's needed legislation for the children of this state, and would appreciate your support, would ask for your favorable consideration. Mr. Speaker, I'd be happy to answer any questions.
You do have a question. Do you yield?
Yes.
Actually, you got several questions now, so you might want to have a good, thorough discussion.
Yes, sir.
Chair recognizes Representative Stovall to your left for a question.
Does the gentleman yield?
Yes, ma'am.
With this changing on the legislation, this bill, will this also be able to assist those families that are now having to take up parental rights with the financial obligation that they would now have to incur?
Representative, I'll try to address your question. I think where you're going with your question, and maybe if I don't answer it completely, you can let me know. But in a proceeding, a juvenile court proceeding, where custody or placement are at issue, then priority would be given to a relative or close family friend of the child. But as far as support or other benefits that the child might be receiving, that would not necessarily be impacted by anything here. The real focus is ensuring that the safety of the child is the priority, and through studies that have been provided to me from my work on this legislation, I've learned that we currently have just over 20% of children being placed with relatives. And there's a real opportunity to increase that number by giving judges in statute the ability to rely upon the law and to show that we, as a body, have made a public policy statement that it's in the best interest of these children to have them with and place them with a relative who has a relationship with them, who knows this child, who cares for this child's best interests. We're in no way taking anything away from the outstanding foster parents that we have across the state. But at the same time, we're recognizing that if the child has a consistent placement with a relative who has known this child for some time, with whom the child has an existing relationship, and the opportunity is for that child to remain with that relative rather than potentially being placed in multiple foster placements, that's in the child's best interest, certainly. And for that reason, Representative Stovall, I'd submit that this is a very important legislation and would encourage your favorable vote.
Do you yield for other questions?
Yes, Mr. Speaker.
Chair recognizes Representative Nimmer to your left for a question.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Does the gentleman yield?
Yes, sir.
Representative F. Strachan, I just wanted to rise and tell you I appreciate your work on 887. I apologize for not coming to you prior, but I know there's a lot of movement. It's Friday, a lot of hum in the House while you were presenting this bill. But I just wanted to point out to everyone's attention, it says it prioritizes the placement of a child. I believe that's the direct intent of this legislation, is to get a child where he or she belongs for the best care. I've had personal experiences dealing with constituents on these very issues, and I appreciate your work on this legislation.
Thank you, Representative. I appreciate your comments. I appreciate your leadership in this area. We have a real opportunity as a body to make a statement here today about how children in Georgia are so important that we are willing to put in the statute that placement with a relative or a close family friend is being undertaken in pursuit of the child's best interest and ensuring their safety, ensuring that they are not in multiple homes or not moving from one placement to another. And I greatly appreciate your assistance with this issue. I appreciate Representative Quick, Leader Abrams. I appreciate the opportunity to work with many members of this body on this bill.
Chair recognizes Chairman Weldon to your left for a question.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Will the gentleman yield?
Yes, sir.
Isn't it true this bill places priority on placement of children that have somehow become in the care of DFACs with their relatives that they're related to by blood or marriage, and also if none of those are available, then be placed with what's been termed as fictive kin?
Yes, sir. That's correct.
And fictive kin is an adult that a child is familiar with and has a relationship with and has spent time with.
That's exactly right.
Okay. Isn't it further true that only the chairman of the judiciary is authorized to spend this much time in the well?
Mr. Chairman, I will spend all the time that's necessary to answer your questions adequately. Chairman Weldon, I want to thank you for your leadership on this issue as well, all your hard work in committee. Chairman Weldon brings up and alerts my attention to another very important point. The language in the bill is specified as an adult who is a relative or fictive kin, of course, statutorily including that such a placement would be with an adult. And I would like to thank you, Mr. Chairman, for your work in this area. Mr. Speaker, I'd be happy to answer any other questions if there are any.
You do not have any further questions.
Thank you. I'll yield the well.
Gentleman has yielded the well. Is there any objection to the previous question being ordered? The chair hears none. The previous question is ordered. Is there any objection to adopting the committee substitute? The chair hears none. The committee substitute is adopted. Is there any objection to agreeing to the report of the committee, which was favorable to the passage of the bill? The chair hears none. The report of the committee is agreed to. Shall this bill now pass? All those in favor of the passage of House Bill 887 will vote aye. Those opposed will vote no, and the clerk will unlock the machines. Have all members voted? Have all members voted? If so, the clerk will lock the machines on the passage of House Bill 887. The ayes are 160, the nays are zero. This bill, having received the requisite constitutional majority, is therefore passed. Clerk will read the caption to House Bill 926.
House Bill 926 by Representative Broderick of the 4th and others, to be entitled an act to amend Chapter 4, Title 26 of the Official Code of Georgia, annotated, relating to pharmacists and pharmacies, so as to provide for the regulation of certain facilities and entities involved in the wholesale, manufacture, and distribution of drugs. This bill has been referred to the Committee on Health and Human Services. That committee recommends that this bill do pass by committee substitute.
Chair recognizes Representative Broderick to present the bill.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Ladies and gentlemen of the House, today I bring you HB 926. 926 adds new definitions to the Pharmacy Practice Act. These definitions are from the Food and Drug Administration and are a result of new laws passed by the FDA, which created new types of distributors and mandated that each state create such licenses for these entities. The intent of the legislation is to assure a safe and effective drug distribution system within the state. There have been some questions on it, and it does let us regulate these types of facilities in the state of Georgia, and again, just assures a safe distribution system for our pharmaceuticals. Mr. Speaker, I'll be glad to answer questions if there are any.
You have a question if you care to yield.
I'll yield, yes, sir.
Chair recognizes Representative Petrie to your left for a question.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Does the gentleman yield?
Yes, I do.
Isn't it true, sir, that I had some concerns earlier on about how this would affect private practice physician organizations, oncologists, and that those have we have found a way to resolve that? They are indeed exempted, and that is no longer a concern to me, sir.
The gentleman knows of what he speaks.
Thank you, sir.
There was some confusion about the terminology of outsourcing facilities for compounding. Thank you for the question. Any other questions?
No further questions.
If there are no further questions, I ask for your support of HB 926, and I feel like it's a good piece of legislation, and it just brings us in compliance with some pretty strong federal rules.
Come around.
And I yield the well. Thank you.
Gentleman has yielded the well. Is there any objection to the previous question being ordered? The chair hears none. The previous question is ordered. Is there any objection to adopting the committee substitute? The chair hears none. The committee substitute is adopted. Is there any objection to agreeing to the report of the committee, which was favorable to the passage of the bill? The chair hears none. The report of the committee is agreed to. Shall this bill now pass? All those in favor of the passage of the bill will vote aye. Those opposed will vote no. And the clerk will unlock the machines. Have all members voted? Have all members voted? If so, the clerk will lock the machine on the passage of House Bill 926. The ayes are 128, the nays are 33. This bill, having received the requisite constitutional majority, is therefore passed. Chair recognizes the chairman of the Rules Committee.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Ladies and gentlemen, there will be a Rules Committee meeting in room 403 at 1 o'clock. 403.
A throwback venue.
Yeah. I got bounced.
Retro.
I've been bounced.
Rules Committee meeting at 1 p.m. in room 403. House will be in lunch recess until 2 p.m.